As part of the Center's functions, one of the things we're proud to do is to co-sponsor this debate with the Lowell Sun tonight for the candidates for representative in the 18th Middlesex District. I want to recognize our Chancellor, who is here with us tonight, at least initially as a spectator, Chancellor Marty Meehan. All of us are very proud of our new facility here. University Crossing just opened. Some of you were here during the primary debate and got a good look at it. Some of you were here for our opening in September. As I say, we're quite proud of this this building. It is sort of the center of the campus now, where students gather on a routine basis for meetings and the advising. All the student services are in here, but it's also a community building. It's a building for you. We have the cafe on the first floor. If you haven't visited yet, we please recommend that you do so. The store, which is called a bookstore, but is much more than that on the first floor, is open to everyone as well. And we encourage you, if you can't come tonight, come some other time. There's free visitor parking next door. Just don't come at 5 o'clock like tonight with the traffic on the bridge. But hopefully that'll be resolved soon. Maybe the candidates might have something to say about that. Without further ado, I want to actually do one sort of piece of housekeeping, and it's more than that, really, because I'm sure if you don't know, most of you do, but we lost a great public figure in Massachusetts earlier today. We were fortunate about a year ago at this time to have former Boston Mayor Tom Menino here on campus. He was a great supporter of the university. He was a great public official who served 20 years as mayor of Boston, and he'll be sorely missed by all of us. I know you feel the same here in Lowell as well as they do in Boston across the country. So I'd like to ask everybody if we could please have a moment of silence for Thomas Menino. Thank you. So, to get started, tonight, to introduce the candidates and the panel and moderating tonight's debate is the Enterprise Editor of the Lowell Sun, Chris Scott. Welcome, Chris Scott, please.
Thanks, Rick. Good evening, everyone, and thanks for coming out tonight. I'll start by just introducing the candidates. Closest to me is Fred Bahou. Fred's a longtime resident of the Highlands, as many of you know, runs a popular convenience store up there. He's been a member of the Greater Lowell Tech School Committee for a number of terms. Frank, thanks for coming out. Fred, I'm sorry.
Great to be here, Chris. Thank you very much.
And next to Fred, obviously, is Rady Mom. Rady Mom is a graduate of the Tech and has a popular business in Couples Square in the heart of the Highlands doing chiropractor.
Therapy, not chiropractor. Okay.
I stand corrected. And the panelists are Tom Zuber is my colleague in the newsroom. Tom is the assistant managing editor for Days. Tom, thanks for being here tonight. You all know Frank. And to Frank's left is Mary Jo Griffin from Middlesex Community College and a good friend of the newspaper. And she will serve as our third panelist tonight. So I'd like to just take care of a couple of house cleaning matters first. Candidates will be given 2 minutes to respond. Then the other candidate will get a minute to rebut. Moderator has the discretion to let them kind of go back and forth if I see something developing. We'll flip a coin to see who gets the first question. The candidate who does not get the first question then has the opportunity to deliver the first closing statement, or that candidate can defer, make it last like kind of like the Bill Belichick move. There is no opening statement, okay? So why don't I just flip the coin now just one other matter. The second debate that was going to happen tonight between Maura Healey and John Miller, the candidates for Attorney General, is not happening, primarily due to Tom Menino's death. John Miller will be here, and he'll make a few remarks. So following this debate, if you all want to stick around and hear what John Miller has to say and what he can bring to the Attorney General's office, you're welcome to do that. He may even take some questions from the audience. I don't know. So with that, we'll just flip the coin and then we can get going. Okay,
can guys? I call it?
Sure. What'd you get?
50-50. I'll take heads. I'm gonna defer my call to Roddy.
Heads.
Tails. No. That's heads. Yes. All right, so you're gonna take the first question, Roddy?
Yes.
Put it back in the nice little change first. All right, so Tom, why don't you start with the first question for Roddy Mom?
Yeah, Mr. Mom, first of all, both candidates, thank you for being here this evening. Mr. Mom, you've been very careful during this campaign to not wade deeply into a lot of the issues about the district or state politics. Matter of fact, you've said often that when you are up at the state house, you're going to listen to your constituents and learn on the job. Do you think state representatives should have stands on the issues going into office, or do you think that he should be learning on the job?
Well, I believe that in our district, the job of each individual elected official is to listen and, of course, to represent the whole district. What is the concern of the citizen? That's a job.
Fred, you have a minute to respond.
Okay, Roddy, thanks.
Okay, moving quickly.
Yes.
Fred, next question to Fred Bahou, please.
For Mr. Bahou, and actually for both candidates, right? We're starting with this one. Massachusetts is widely considered to be a national leader on education, but state support for public education, particularly public higher education, does not match that reputation. Unfortunately. From 2001 to 2013, only six of the 50 states cut public higher education by more than Massachusetts did. What would be your legislative agenda in regard to public higher education, Mr. Bob?
I think public higher education is one of the things we can do to move our colleges and community colleges forward, as well as our college students. And to go ahead and move it forward, me being a member of the Great Lowell Tech, I've really developed a firm belief in that we should be using our vocational schools with our community colleges as well as with our universities. As far as our vocational schools go, I have been created a rally cry about this, and I know Middlesex Community College just went ahead and joined us in an effort to teach metal fabrication with them, with us simultaneously. So they're having our students, their students, come to our building and learn metal fab. With that being the case, we can go ahead and get the students job ready with vocational programming. The other thing that we can go ahead and do is try to offer more scholarships. And I think the way to offer more scholarships to students is by looking at our budget, looking at our $1.8 billion in extra rainy day funds, and start offering college education to people that really can't afford it and don't know that they can qualify for a loan or ever be able to pay it back.
Roddy?
Thank you, Frank. As a graduate of the Daly School, the Vocational School, and Middlesex Community College, I understand the value of education. When we talk about higher education, we have this beautiful campus right here in our district, which is the 18th Middlesex District. I will fight for Chapter 70 to make sure we have the funding that is adequate for our schooling. I will ask to be on the Committee of Education should I get to Beacon Hill. I will go and fight for the 18th Middlesex District and the entire city of Lowell. That's what I will do.
Thank you. Mary Jo, a question for Mr. Bahou?
Would that be Mr. Bahou?
I think it's Mr.
Mom. No, Roddy, you finished your answer, correct?
I believe we're alternating. Roddy had the first question.
Yeah, he just...
I didn't rebut, and then I had the second question. And
oh, okay. I'm sorry.
That's okay. Thank you.
It's for both of you. What do you feel is the biggest difference between yourself and your opponent?
This to me, first of all. Well, for starter, I know that, first of all, I congratulate Fred, and for both of us to putting our name on a ballot, it's very tough. We all want the best thing. And I have a proven record that I've been involved in the community for over 20 plus years already. Whether it's involved with the Boys and Girls Club or in the Uncle Dan's crew, which connected to the youth to teach them about culture, building relationship, building leadership. That's what I got to stand on as a small businessman. I work on one-to-one basis to serve the community, to help. I help people every day in my line of work. I'm so proud to have that opportunity right here in the 18 Middlesex District in our great city of Lowell. I'm proud of that.
But how is that different from your opponent?
I guess that's what I do as my job, to serve the people.
How am I different from Mr. Mum? I've been in the district all my life. I've invested in the district regularly. You know, I was a paper boy in the district, and I was a person that raked leaves in the district. I was a person that has coached baseball in the district. I'm a person that played baseball and basketball in the district, and coached basketball in the district as well. I've invested in 5 properties in the district. I've rehabbed property on 254 Foster Street, which is where my children and my wife live, or my former wife. And I've rehabbed the house on 251 Foster Street and sold it and really helped that neighborhood spruce up, because it sold at a very low price. And I think a lot of the neighbors were worried that it may sell for too low of a price and it could damage the neighborhood. I purchased a home on 772 Westford Street and rehabbed that. And unfortunately, it was during the mortgage crisis, or the plummeting of real estate values, and I took a pretty large hit on that. And I purchased another house on Gibson Street.
You can finish it.
Okay, but at the end of the day, I mean, I come job ready. I'm elected twice by people in the city of Lowell, and I sit on many, many different committees at the Green Wall Tech. So.
Thanks, Frank. Tom Zuko with a question for Mr. Bahou.
Mr. Bahou, which is more important to the district, Chapter 78 or Chapter 98?
Well, that's a very good question.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm not sure what Chapter 78 or 98.
70.
Chapter
70?
Oh, 70. Well, I mean, I'm a firm believer in education. I think a Chapter 70 is what covers our municipal government, and it is something that really moves our school districts forward. And I think that it's something that we need in order to go ahead and progress our cities. So if I were to choose between Chapter 70 and Chapter 90, I would choose Chapter 70 just because of the educational value that it offers our cities and towns.
Roddy, you want to take a crack at that one?
The question is the difference between Chapter...
Which do you think is more important to the district?
Well, quite honestly, I know that education is one of the most important factor for all of our family and our children. So I would definitely say Chapter 70 is definitely very, very important to make sure that all of our children get educated.
Frank,
can I just ask a follow-up question, sir?
Sure thing.
What's Chapter 90?
Chapter 90 is for bridge and road.
Right. Thank you. Very
good. Frank, you have a question for Mr. Mom?
I do. Thanks, Chris. Lowell City Manager Kevin Murphy and Chancellor Marty Meehan met with almost 200 students, faculty, and staff from the university earlier this week, day before yesterday, I think it was, right here in this room, to discuss the topic of how Lowell might become an even more vibrant college town. What proposals would you make that would further that goal as representative of the 18th Middlesex District?
I think, first of all, the university to be here in our great city is amazing. I applaud the Chancellor for the work that he put forward to build an amazing campus. We are a college town, and I'm excited. I will do everything that I can possibly to make sure that our college continue to grow, and I will support any funding that I can bring back from Beacon Hill to make sure our college is affordable for all of the residents of the 18th Middlesex and the entire city of Lowell.
Mr. Bobby?
Developing, the college has developed. So what would be something that I would focus on? I would say a few things. Small businesses, me being a small business owner. I know there are a lot of people that are unemployed, or, you know, our unemployment rate is fairly high. Many people like to have the idea that they could go ahead and start a small business. And I think starting a small business is important. And I think it's one of those things that if you could go ahead and get people to begin to work for themselves, it would be something that they could grab onto, and they could, you know, have a great teaching tool towards other people in their family and in their community. I think to develop the downtown would be a great place to start. I think there would be a great need for a Trader Joe's downtown. Or, you know, somebody said to me the other day, they said, hey, how about a Chipotle? And I'm like, yeah, Chipotle, Five Guys. I think those things are what the college town could go ahead and use, because we have Middlesex Community College, Lowell High School. And to go ahead and attract the type of consumer, which is the student, would be a great way to develop the downtown. And the Trader Joe's would be all about the mill complexes that people are now living in. Those are our residences. We all love to go to Market Basket. I know I'm at Market Basket all the time. But at the end of the day, Trader Joe's would be a wonderful option.
I agree. Mary Jo, you have a question for Mr. Bahou.
Mr. Bahou, speaking of college town, we are all quite aware of the rash of violence that's been taking place in, specifically in your district, the 18th Middlesex. Yes. Beyond the good work and the hard work the police department is doing, do you have any proposals or ideas to help stop the rash amount of crime that's taking place?
What's going on all around us in the 18th Middlesex District? A pizza shop right down the street from my shop was robbed the other night, and they actually had the employees go face down on the ground in their business as the people were stealing their money and pointing guns at them. People are feeling like they're shut into their homes. There's shots being fired at homes, on highways. A few other robberies happened in the past few nights as well. Yes, there's a rash of violence. And I don't know if I want to send my daughter to school here if I hear that in the news. What would I propose? Firstly, neighborhood policing. I think it's important to go ahead and offer neighborhood policing to people, to people in the city, so they can identify that the neighborhood, that the cops know the people in the neighborhood. I think another thing would be to implement that Bobby Fox bill. I think it's important that we send people to jail and send the message to the youth of the city of Lowell that people are going to go to jail if they keep having illegal guns, or if they're shooting guns. And it can't be done in a time when it's a year wait before they go to jail. It has to be done more instantly. So we need to utilize the courts, the sheriff's department, the police department, and the prosecution department to make sure this goes swiftly.
Thank you, Fred. Roddy?
Thank you. I know the public safety is probably one of the most important issue right now. You know, knocking over 2,000 plus doors. Every citizen that opened a door, and by the way, thank you to the district for opening the doors and talking to me. They're very, very concerned. I will support Chief Taylor and the entire police department in their effort to combat crime. I will also file an amendment to support the shot spotter, which the city council have already unanimously voted on, to make sure that funding come back so that the Lowell police will have a tool that is very effective to combat crime. The guns that are here in our city are illegal. They're not legal guns. And we're living right next to the land of the free, which is just 15 minutes away. We have to have a deal with...
You can finish your thought.
Where we can communicate with the next state, so that it's a one unification law.
Tom Zuber, you have a question?
Can I clarify about that?
Yeah, go ahead.
Shot stoppers. I'm not sure exactly what that entails, Roddy. And I'm not sure if there's ever been any arrests made with shot stoppers. So would you be sure what that is?
Yes. Shot spotters have already in place in Worcester and Boston. When a gun is fired, it instantaneously connects to the cruiser. So without having the citizen to dial 911, The police can arrive at the scene within a minute. We need that. We don't have it. We need that in Lowell. And I'm all for it.
How much does it cost?
$415,000 in a 3-year period.
Okay, guys, thanks. Tom, you have a question for Roddy Mom?
Yes, Mr. Mom. In a 5-year period, 2008 to 2012, nearly 100 people in Lowell died due to opioid abuse and overdoses. Most of those are male, and most of them are ages 25 to 54, so they're not the usual group that you think of when we're talking about drug overdoses. If you're elected, you go to State House. What's your plan to tackle opioid abuse and overdoses in your district?
Tom, as we said before, when it comes to drugs or any problem we have, whether it is in our city or in Boston, or for that matter, in all of our great city and town, we do have a drug problem. I believe education is probably one of the most important things that we can reach for. We have to have education, not just one time in class. We need to educate our children 195 days all the way through the entire school year. That's what we have to do, so that they will understand that not to get connected with the drug.
You have another minute. Do you want to use it?
No.
Okay.
I agree that drug awareness is something that we should go ahead and offer. I speak, unfortunately, you know, in my business, I get to see a lot of the drug addicts, people that are addicted, and I ask them how they're doing, and sometimes they're doing okay, and other times they're gone for a little while. And I think one of the things that they've shared with me is that we should offer drug awareness a couple of times a year at the schools, and it should be somewhere beginning in the mid-grades, seventh grade, and they do it in October coming into the school year so that we can make them aware of drugs, and also have an awareness program in May before they head out for the summer. And to identify that is a measure that we can take in order to go ahead and make people more aware of drugs. I visited UTEC. UTEC's an awesome place. And it's a no-holds-barred type of place. Feel free to come in. Feel free to utilize our vocational studies. Feel free to utilize what we have here, this safe house to go ahead and play ping pong or play pool. And I think it's one of those places that kids need to know that they can go there and they can get off the streets and not be committed to the problems that they're having. So that would be a couple of my thoughts.
Thanks, Fred. I think Tom has a follow-up.
Actually, I follow up specifically with Mr. Mom. When you talk about teaching in school, drug education 195 days a year, how do you fit that into the time and learning issues that they have in class now, where they're trying to do transition to Common Core curriculum and those types of things? It doesn't seem like there's a lot of time during the school day to fit in a daily drug education. You're talking curriculum or programs, or could you expand on that, please?
Thank you. I know that education is one of the most important keys. It's not that we wait until they are in high school to teach this. We can teach them at a younger, from pre-K on, to understand about this stuff. We have plenty of the academic to put all this forward. And that would be connecting to the superintendent school to make sure that curriculum is in place. Whether it's as simple as, let's understand about drugs, we need to bring the professional into this so that they know how to resolve this issue. My job is to bring resource back to make sure that it's in place.
Fred, any further comments?
Sure, and I think it's ongoing with that, you know, the plan that I spoke about back for teaching in October and teaching in May. I think you also teach it in health classes regularly. I think that's one way to go ahead and make people more aware of drugs. It's about keeping them from getting started. And also, it's about making sure that, you know, there are safe houses in the city of Lowell. There's one on Harvard Street of women that have been addicted to drugs and alcohol. There's one down on Cabot Street, and it's important that we have these safe houses for them and they come clean. And I guess when I speak to people over at the drug house, a Lowell, I can't think of the name of the place, they said, Fred, what they do, I says, how do you keep the drugs out of here? I says, well, you know, what do you do about that? And they said, what they do, Fred, is that people will rat each other out if you know, there's drugs coming in this building because they're trying to clean themselves up. So, you know, those are a couple of plans that I would go ahead and try to stay involved with to try to clear up our very
sad problem. Frank, you have a question for Mr. Bahou.
I do. So, as you know, Lowell has been designated now for a quarter of a century, really, a national park by the federal government and a state historical park by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. The city, as well, has a historic board whose responsibilities include ensuring that store and building facades, in particular, in the historic district are consistent with the historic theme of the city. Lowell Sun recently ran a series of reports on this question. Do you support continued enforcement of these historical codes, or do you think that businesses should be able to make those decisions for themselves? And generally, how would you come down on the tension between historic preservation and business development?
I think the person who runs the historic preservation department identified that you can't hold all these businesses accountable to make this town, this historical town, have the perfect historical facades. So they've indicated to the business owners, we're willing to work with you as long as you don't go over the top. We want our city clean. We want our storefronts clean. We want to be attractive to people in the city and to visitors that come into the city. And we want to do this without being a burden on small businesses. So, and I'm a small business, and I've looked at some type of funding and historical stuff like that, and I just said to myself, I don't know that I could have kept it up. But, you know, I try to do as best as I can. We're a brick city, we're a mill city, and to have, you know, the brick storefront in front of my place like I do, that's actually something that I did in 1986, because it was originally a stucco building. So I think if they can afford it, let's offer it. But if they can't afford it, let's try to work with them and just let them know that, you know, we want to work with them, but, you know, we're not going to tie your hands and we're not going to burden you with costs.
Thanks, Frank Roddy.
Lowell is a gateway city. And I think one of the uniqueness of our city is our history. I would love to make sure that we have some historical that goes with that. If we are able to, and again, we talk about funding from the state and also the historical board. I used to be on the board of LOCA, that's going way back in the 90s. There's a lot to see, to offer. And this is the uniqueness of the goods of our city. And I hope to keep that moving forward.
Thank you, Roddy. Mary Jo, you have a question for Roddy Mom.
Roddy, if you are elected, are you going to collect the per diem travel? And if not, would you consider proposing legislation that would eliminate it?
As of right now, I would probably say no.
You would not take it?
I would not.
Would you propose legislation that would eliminate it altogether?
I don't know the full extent of what I have to participate in. I can only answer for myself at this point.
For a doctor.
Okay, I think the proposed legislation would be something to have a little discussion with, because the whole idea is you want to go ahead and have support. So if I went in there, and really thinking, I hope to be a state rep, and I'm really excited to be able to take the train into Boston, because I'll have that downtime and I won't have to be fighting traffic and looking for a parking spot and such like that. But I know there'll be days that I have to take my car in. But you know, as far as going after the per diem rate, I think that sort of comes into my thought of what the pay structure is for being a state representative. So, I mean, I wouldn't be one that we would be trying to tackle on and grabbing on to that. I guess it's $26 per day. But I would also talk to the other state reps and see if they would like to go ahead and start to, have the discussion of removing that from the benefit package, per se.
Thanks, Fred. All right, Tom, you have a question for Mr. Bahou.
Mr. Bahou, you're one of the two candidates who's an elected public official on the Greater Lowell Tech School Committee. And I want to ask you about a meeting that occurred a couple of years ago. It was a very heated discussion about the school committee knowing the whereabouts of the school superintendent. And you supported that motion. And during your support of that motion, you said the intention of the article was not to, was to find out whether the superintendent was out sick or taking a vacation day, and I quote you directly, not about, are you golfing, are you doing your makeup, are you in the hospital? Do you think that's a proper statement for a public official?
No, I think I was caught up in a conversation, and sometimes as we're standing here in a little debate, you get yourself a little worked up and you can catch yourself saying things when you don't mean it the way that it's being interpreted. I remember as I was saying it, I was looking at Mike Lindsay, and Mike Lindsay and George O'Hare, who was sitting across the table from me, were just giving me smirks. And I'm like, oh boy, did I make a big mistake on that. So as far as the discussion went, you know, I think it was brought up by a colleague of mine. And it was about, you know, we would like to know if you're out of the building, so if you could just go ahead and inform us, that would be, you know, in our best interest, that we're not calling the school, and, you know, we're not calling the secretary and not knowing whether you're in or not, and trying to just, you know, get whatever school committee questions we have out of the way. So really, that was what it was all about. And as far as, you know, my comments, I think they were sort of incorrect. And I probably should have said something like, if you're going to be out, if you're home, ill, or if there's a personal day that you need to have, maybe it's probably in the best interest of all of us just to inform us.
Thanks, Fred. Roddy, do you have anything to say on that?
I think the question was for Fred, so.
Thank you. Frank, a question for Roddy Mom, please.
Yes, for both candidates, too.
Ms.
Mom, if you are successful next Tuesday and become a state representative from this district, how will you stay in touch with the voters and constituents of this district to make sure that you know what their priorities are and how they feel about issues generally?
Frank, the first thing that I will do, I will open an office right here in my district so that the 18 Middlesex district citizen and all voters can have a chance to come and meet with me and have a conversation with me. And I will continue to service to the best of my ability. And that is to listen to them. And we'll leave.
Well, I think we all know that I own a local convenience store. And I sell newspapers and coffee, and people like to come out there and hang out and tell me what their thoughts are, whether it was yesterday's great pitching performance by the gentleman, I can't pick up. Baumgarten. Or if they want to come and talk about the issues of the state government, I would always be available in the mornings for them prior to going to Boston as often as I can. The big deal about me being in the district, I only do things in the district. You know, my ex-wife said I was pretty dull. You know, I golf in the district, I go to church in the district, I go to the market in the district. It's something that has been a part of me all my life. I coach baseball in the district, I go to the parks in the district. So for me to be involved with people in the district has really never been an issue. So I'm sure that I would be able to find out what their needs and wants are and go ahead and discuss it with them.
Can I ask a follow-up?
Absolutely.
Sort of related to that, maybe starting with Mr. Mom. Mm-hmm. I'm guessing, and I could be wrong, but I think maybe right, that you're going to occasionally confront a decision that you have to make that you think, in your mind, is in the best interests of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts that may not be very popular in your district. How do you deal with that? And what would your process be for making that decision?
That's fine. Roddy, take it.
Thank you. I know that as a legislator and to govern, I have to make hard decisions. And that's what I have to do. And on top of that, my job is to let all of my constituents understand the process that I go through. I will ask them as well, what does the need of the district, but more importantly, the decision that I will make. I will make that hard decision. I will take that. I stand behind it.
Fred?
I think one of the tightest votes we've taken in Massachusetts in the past 25 years is this restoration of the death penalty. And I think it came down to roughly a 88 vote. And it was a heated debate, and it came from the boy that got kidnapped, that had his bicycle, and got, Curly was his name, if I remember correctly, and that's why legislation moved forward. And there was a lot of discussion about that, and it was being discussed everywhere around the state of Massachusetts. I think at the end of the day, if people came up to me and said, hey, you know, how are you on this one? I says, well, what do you want to tell me about this one that I think, that you think that I should know that I probably already haven't heard? And they'll share with me, and then somebody else will come up on the other side of the issue. And I'll ask them the same type of question. And I will develop my thoughts and my summaries and try to come up with what I think is the best choice. And when I have my best choice, I will go ahead and I will interpret that and share that with the people that are asking me those questions. Or the people that realistically may be on the other side and be unhappy with me, and just let them know it wasn't against them. It was about a particular way that I went ahead and analyzed this whole situation and was able to come up with a conclusion.
Thanks, Rick. You brought up the death penalty. If that came back to the legislature, how would you vote on that?
You know, that's a tough call. Again, I think I'd have to be in that dialogue. But realistically, I would probably be for it. Only if it was something that the person was definitely guilty of. You know, in this particular curly incident with a boy that got kidnapped and got raped and got murdered, I think I would, you know, be very much in favor of that.
How about you, Robbie?
So the question is, if the death penalty is brought back, mm-hmm. Now the governor of the law of Massachusetts, as of right now, we don't have a death penalty. I have to go by no to the death penalty, because from what that we learned so far, some of the inmates that are in there, they're not even in the right purpose, so there's more to be visited in the law. And make sure that every respect to each individual case is taken correctly.
Okay, thank you. Mary Jo, a question for Mr. Bahou.
Mr. Bahou, of the four ballot questions, which do you believe will have the most impact on our city, and how will you vote on that question?
Casinos, water, unemployment, and gasoline. On our city, oh boy, that's a hard one. Can I pick two? My little Panera Bread.
You can pick two.
Yeah, no, well, I guess gas, because, you know, I wouldn't really want to have that automatic, you know, tax increase based on inflation. I think if we want to fix roads, and I want a New York Bridge, and I think a New York Bridge is very much needed in the city of Lowell, Massachusetts. I remember the day they opened that work bridge. I asked my good friend Steve, he was going to visit his girlfriend in Tingsboro back in 1980. I'm like, how was it? I'm like, they gave him 12 minutes. Usually takes me 20. I'm like, yeah, great. Well, now I take my kayak underneath it and I walk my dog across it and I walk across it and it's pretty beat. You know, there's panels showing and, you know, it's always being beefed up and it's a problem. So, yes, I would definitely think that, you know, we need a bridge, but I don't think the automatic tax increases. I think the casino would add something very unique to the state of Massachusetts, because we already are a destination city. With that being the case, it just makes people want to come to Boston even more. It's, you know, there's a lot of dangers of gambling, and I understand that. But people gamble, you know, and they will gamble. And they drive down to Foxwoods, and they drive to Mohegan Sun. They might even call somebody that they know to wager a bet, or they may even go online and gamble that way as well. So, I mean, are we going to be able to fix that problem? I don't think so. And what could the infrastructure do for Everett, Massachusetts? What could all those jobs being created to go ahead and build into that infrastructure of Everett, Massachusetts be like? And how will it benefit the state of Massachusetts, as well as, let's be real here, Chelsea and Revere and all those surrounding towns that are around Everett?
Thank you, Fred. Right on.
So we got four ballot questions. I got to tell you, it's quite confusing. It's one of those yes, but no, it's no to yes. You really do have to read it. Trying to help a couple of the voter that asked me the question was, we had to really read it again and again. So the first one is gas increase tax. Again, I believe this is a yes, but technically it's no, so I'm not for that. I believe that we should have the ability to vote as a legislator. It shouldn't be automatic. Second is the bottle bill. Again, this is one of those backward. In our city, we have done a wonderful job in recycling curb already. I'm not for the bottle bill. And the third, I believe, is the gambling bill. I look at it as entertainment. Now, most of us, we go out to eat, we watch movies. And for some of us, entertainment is...
Tom, take it away. You have a question for Mr. Mom. Mr. Mom, over the summer, Governor Patrick signed a buffer zone bill. And what this does is it preserves protesters' right to free speech in front of an abortion clinic, but allows patients and employees to go about their business without with a zone where they don't have to face harassment. Are you pro-choice or pro-life, and do you agree with this law?
First of all, I believe in that it is up to the woman's right and their doctor. It's not up to the government. It's a woman's right. It's up to the woman to make their own decision. That's between the woman and the doctor.
But, excuse me, specifically about the buffer zone, do you support the idea of a buffer zone around abortion clinics?
As long as it doesn't harass me, the woman who is trying to go on with their lives. That's why we have laws. Mr. Bahou.
Pro-choice. However, I do not believe in partial birth abortions, just to share that. buffer zone. Well, you know, let's be real. I mean, if I want to go into church and people are protesting in front of my church, you know, I would hate for them to follow me right in the door and saying, you know, I don't want you going in there because, you know, they're not pro-choice. Buffer zone, I'm trying to get votes right here in this room. And I go on and I work and I knock on doors and I try to get people to vote for me. I see people that are sitting on two sides of the room. And some of them I know very well, but I know, you know, they're not gonna be voting for me, but that's okay. So when people go and vote, they're gonna sort of walk by an area where it's their safe zone. I cannot go up to them anymore. I can't go any further to a point because I've done all my work. When a woman has made a choice that she's going to have an abortion, she's given it a lot of thought, and it's not an easy thought. There's a lot of consideration, there's a lot of advice, and at the end of the day, I believe that a buffer zone would be very unfair to not harass them as they're going into a clinic.
Thank you. Frank, it's your turn with a question.
Yes, for Ms. Mom or for you? Okay, well, it's for both, so they can take it in whichever order you choose. A few years ago, the legislature debated the issue of judicial appointments, and specifically the question about whether or not Massachusetts should consider changing the way that judges are selected in Massachusetts, where, as you know, they're appointed by the governor and confirmed by the governor's council. Two-thirds of the states elect their judges now, and there's periodic pressure for Massachusetts to contemplate changing the way that Massachusetts both appoints judges and continues judges in office. Do you have a position on that, and what would your position be in the legislature?
Now, this is to Mr. Bahou, then you'll get a chance.
That's a tough call. You know, here's the deal. If you want to go ahead and run for judgeship, you begin to politicize it. You begin to owe favors out. And you begin to sort of get manipulated into the people that have endorsed your candidacy or donated to your candidacy. So, you know, that may work in two-thirds of the country. I don't know that it's the best choice. There's appointments going on. You know, I'm a firm believer in evaluations. I think at the end of the day, if I get elected for this job, 2 years from now, people are going to evaluate me. And they're like, hey, did Freddie do a good enough job? And if he didn't, then I may very much vote for, you know, the guy that was his opposition last time, because Roddy may run against me if I so win. So I think that evaluation process of judges would be the most fair, as well as opportunistic for our state of Massachusetts to hold our judges and our courts accountable.
Thank you, Fred Roddy.
Thank you. I believe in getting the best candidate. So if that require voting, electing a judge, I'm all for that. It's getting the best candidate, the best judge to serve the greater good.
Do you think that that's how you're going to get the best judges, is by having it be decided by the electorate?
I think this is how we're going to find out who's the best candidate, is whether it's going through their status of what they stand for and representing the, I guess, on the judicial level.
Okay, we've been going now about 50 minutes, so why don't we make this the last question. Mary Jo, you have a question for Roddy?
This is the last question?
Yes.
We can stick around for another hour or so. That helps.
Okay. Then how about, since you both talked about your investment in your district in the Highlands area here in Lowell, what is your position on the Westview Road project?
Roddy, this is Europe.
Well, thank you for the question. The best Westview, I have to say, I really have no idea where the Westview is on that one. Where is the best?
The proposed, that's been going back and forth with the proposed housing out behind the golf course.
Oh, yes, yes, I'm sorry, just the street, just I know exactly where that is. That is actually right behind Mount Pleasant.
Right.
I know exactly where that is.
Okay.
I think this is all about economic development. But again, we got private golf course. If the golf course itself and the member are ready to give up the land, and if it is the ability to open up for businesses and creating more housing, I'm all for it. But it has to be looked on both sides. What are they willing to do? Decision has to be made. What does both party wants?
But do you think it's a good plan to put homes at the end of Westview Road as developer Daly had proposed about a year ago?
I think it is. We need it. We need a housing.
Fred?
I don't know. I think at the end of the day, I'm not sure if I like the question too much. Because I believe the land has been sold. And I think David went ahead and sold it to, you know, somebody that lives back there that could afford it, and it's really a non-issue at this current time. But I will tell you this. I was walking down Westview Road yesterday, and I was thinking about that because I was knocking on doors in the Lowell Sun Call, as a matter of fact. But anyway, I was walking down that street, and I'm like, yeah, the street is pretty narrow. The street is pretty narrow. But then, if I remember correctly, the proposal was that Mr. Daly was saying that he wanted to widen the street, and he was going to go ahead and pay to widen the street. But still, I just don't know that this conversation really needs to take place, so I'm just going to have to pass on this particular question. If you want to ask another one, I'm up for that.
Okay, Fred, do you want to take the first closing statement?
Okay, well, I think Roddy won, so I guess that might have been...
No, but you get the chance.
Oh, I get the chance?
You can go first, or you can defer.
I'll defer.
Roddy, you've got 2 minutes. Try to use the 2 minutes this time.
We'll get another question.
Well, first of all, let me thank the university and Lowell Sun for putting on this wonderful debate forum where you, the voter of the 18 Middlesex District, have a chance to be both me and Fred. I want to thank my family, my wife Sarati and my beautiful daughter, who are here, my two boys. I think they're helping clean the house today. I thank you so very much. It is such a wonderful, wonderful time in the campaign. I learned a lot. It's meeting all of the different citizens that care very much. I learned one thing, and that is that we all care very much about our community. I will go to Beacon Hill to fight for all of you, the 18 Middlesex District and the entire city. It's that important to me. It is personal when we, the citizens of the 18 Middlesex District and the city, worry about public safety. When I feel that it's not safe to let my children leave my door. There's something wrong with that. Given my history, where I came from already, I hope to live in a wonderful city. And Lowell is an unbelievable city. It opened its arms to me, and now it's time for me to give back. And I can do that by going to Beacon Hill to fight for you, to bring back resources for the 18th Municipal District. I sincerely ask for your vote. Number 4, thank you so much.
You have 25 seconds.
You got 2 or 3 minutes.
You got 2 minutes, right? Take it away.
Okay. If elected, I'll be committed to the people of the 18th Middlesex District. I know that I'll be on a 2-year contract. I'm willing to go ahead and take that chance and work on behalf of you and see if I can do that. I will be job ready. I've been elected. I'm sorry. I've been doing constituent services my whole life. I'm a paper boy. I shoveled snow. I worked in the district my whole life. I've been a person that is, when people come in and ask me for advice, I offer the advice. They ask me for apartments. I find them apartments only if they're valuable, because of course I'm recommending them to people that I already know. If they're asking for contractors, electricians, masons, carpenters, you know, people who want to put in windows, I'm that guy. They come to me. I do that. 1973 to 75, I played baseball at the High Little League. And, you know, 75 to 77, I played basketball. I wasn't much of a basketball player. 2001 to 05, I coached at Cowley Park. I'm a member of the Friends of Tyler Park. I'm a member of the Highlands Neighborhood Association. I'm job ready. When I went to the Greater Lowell Tech, there was 450 people on our waiting list. Currently, there's 115 people on our waiting list, and we've increased our student body by 200 pupils in that period of time. Our lawyer's fees were over $150,000 annually for the past few years. They've been reduced to $50,000. I successfully negotiated, I was on a negotiation team this year to develop a teacher's contract that saved us $350,000 annually, and in the fourth year will save us $700,000. Our last contract took 22 months. 4 things I will focus on: public safety, which is of course car brakes, home brakes, community policing, drug addiction. We've hit on that. I think you know my feelings on that. I focus on, you know, completing the funding for the Hamilton Canal District. I think that to get that new courthouse in there would be huge because of the current courthouse that we're in. And lastly, we all know how I feel about a work bridge. I've resided in the 18th Middlesex District my whole life. I understand its needs. I will constantly work on constituent services, as did my predecessor, Kevin Murphy, as well as Steve Panzatakis before him. And I will always be regularly available. Please vote for Bahou on November 4.
Thank you, candidates. I'd like to remind members of the audience that John Miller is in the House. So if you want to hear more about the Republican running for Attorney General, tonight's your night. Thank you all.